Good evening, everyone. My name is Douglas Sprang, and I lead the Energy and Environment Series for the MIT Club of Northern California. I'm delighted to kick off our 2022-2023 season, featuring top speakers in the fields of renewable energy, electric vehicles, drought in California, and of course, climate change. Our speaker this evening is MIT's Jacopo Buongiorno, TEPCO Professor of Nuclear Engineering and the Director of Science and Technology for the MIT Nuclear Reactor Laboratory. His topic for this evening is the future of nuclear energy, which will primarily address the technologies, trends, and issues of nuclear fission, not fusion. We plan to cover that in 2023, but nuclear fission today is the workhorse technology for nuclear. And so it's appropriate to the future, at least in the next 10 or 20 years, is wrapped very, very heavily around fission. It's our conviction that nuclear energy done right is clean, safe, and can provide the base load energy that solar and wind cannot. If this is not the case, then how can one explain the multi-decade success of our nuclear submarine fleet, not to mention our greater than 100 civilian nuclear power plants, which provide more than half of all carbon-free electricity today in the US? In truth, the primary issues involve capital, initial cost, and time to implement, all of which are being addressed by new reactor designs. Tonight's event is a record setter for our Energy and Environment series with over 300 registrations. In fact, 341 at the last count. And it's the first time we've ever gone over 300 and an expected live audience of nearly 200. And we'll find out how that goes. So this is the biggest we've ever had for our virtual events. And we thank you for supporting our program and excited about doing this one. We have enabled live Q&A, and I'll do my best to get many of these questions to our moderator, Larry Kelly. However, that's during the Q&A session, along with many of the questions that we got from registration, which were also numerous. However, tonight's very large audience will mean that we'll only be able to answer a small fraction of your live Q&A, and we apologize for that, but there's just the limits of because of the size of the audience. But before we get started, I'm delighted to introduce Sarah Simon, who leads the MIT Alumni Energy, Environment, and Sustainability Network, also known as EESN, which is co-sponsoring tonight's event. Over to you, Sarah.
Thank you, Doug. Good evening, all. Sarah Simon here. I am the director of the MIT Alumni EESN, and I'm a civil engineer with an MIT degree. I'm also pleased to know, being head of a alumni network, that both Professor Buongiorno and our moderator hold degrees from the MIT Nuclear Science and Engineering Department. Now, that's not to say that they don't have any other degrees, but they're alums like Doug and I are. EESN provides education, connects alums, and supports their action in creating a sustainable future. We co-sponsor this program as our October webinar. Our mailing list reaches 4,000 MIT alums, and more than 2,000 people have attended our webinars over the past couple of years. They are largely focused on challenges that our global energy, food, and economic systems must overcome to protect Earth's environment for a sustainable future. I hope many of you will join us for subsequent events. In 2005, the MIT Energy Lab published Sustainable Energy, Choosing Among Options. It stated, quote, that it is difficult to envision how, over the longer term, the US can adopt a low carbon energy society without a substantial contribution from nuclear energy. 15 years later, we find we have not taken enough action to reduce carbon emissions and prevent the devastating changes to our world that we all can see these days. Safety and reliability are still very key issues, but we know that progress has been made since the Kyoto Protocol in the economics of solar and wind energy electricity generation. We know we've made improvements in energy efficiency over the last couple of decades and also in reducing waste. So I'm eager to hear tonight's presentation, and I turn it back to you, Doug, to get us going.
Thanks, Sarah. So wanted to mention actually that this event is best viewed in gallery mode. So if all of you out there that would prefer to put it that way, when we have more than one person on screen, they'll be side by side as if it's a fireside chat, and that's what we're trying to create the environment for. Well, now it's time for our program to begin. I'll be back at the end to close things out, but I would like now to introduce our moderator and longtime energy and environment contributor, Larry Kelly, who will orchestrate tonight's fireside chat. Take it away, Larry.
Yeah, thank you very much, Doug. I turned the video on, but it doesn't show up on the screen. Can you guys see me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, good. Okay. All right. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Jacopo Buongiorno for as our featured speaker tonight. Jacopo, thank you very much. JB, it is always so good to see you. And it is my considerable pleasure to be here in this webinar with you. Jacopo is the TEPCO Professor of Nuclear Science and Engineering at MIT and is the Director of Science and Technology at the MIT Nuclear Reactor Lab. And he teaches a variety of undergraduates and graduate courses in thermofluids engineering and nuclear reactor engineering. Jacopo has published over 100 journal articles in areas such as reactor safety and design, two-phase flow and heat transfer, and nanofluid technology. For his research work and his teaching at MIT, he has won several awards, among which is an American Nuclear Society Presidential Citation, which was this year, I believe, an ANS Outstanding Teacher Award, the MIT McVicker Faculty Fellowship, the ANS Landis Young Member Engineering Achievement Award, and the ASME Heat Transfer Best Paper Award, and the ANS Mark Mills Award. That's really an impressive list. That speaks to being the man in the arena and not the critic on the side. Jacopo is the director of the Center for Advanced Nuclear Energy Systems. And in 2016 and 18, he led the study on the future of nuclear engineering in a carbon-constrained world for MIT. Jacopo is a consultant to the nuclear industry in the area of reactor thermal hydraulics, and is a member of the accrediting board of the National Academy of Nuclear Training. He's also been a member of the Secretary of Energy's advisory board and a fellow of the American Nuclear Society Committee on Fukushima, and a member of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, and a past member of the Naval Studies Board, and a participant in the Defense Science Study Group. Jacopo is from Milan, Italy, got his bachelor's degree in nuclear engineering at the Polytechnic of Milan, and then came to MIT and got his PhD in 4 years. So you're a 4-year PhD and got your degree in 2000. That's just fabulous. That's the technical background. But what about the person? And Jacopo and I had a chance to talk a few days ago, and I learned that he grew up in Milan. What a wonderful place to grow up. You know, you have the Duomo Cathedral, the La Scala Opera, Da Vinci's famous painting of the Last Supper, the Sforza Castle. And then of course there's the scrumptious food, the cotoletta alla Milanese and the ossobuca. But we digress. Coming from an area with such great art and literature, you must have considered a career in the arts. How did you get interested in nuclear? What led you to this field?
Well, Larry, first, thanks for inviting me. Thank you, Doug and Sarah. It's a real pleasure to be here and with many other alumni online. And thanks for asking the question about the career in art. Interestingly enough, at the end of high school, when it came the time to decide what to do in college, I was torn between classic literature and engineering. And within engineering, I didn't really know which flavor to take or to pick. And, you know, after many conversations with my parents, I was, I think, wisely recommended to pursue engineering rather than classic literature, which I continue to pursue as a personal interest on the side. But then the perhaps more interesting part was how did I take nuclear as opposed to the many other flavors of engineering that that are attractive, appealing, and they were available to me back at that time. And to be perfectly honest with you, back then I picked the one that sounded the coolest. And so nuclear to me sounded mysterious and interesting. And here we are 30 years later, and I still think that it's a great discipline and it's an interesting technology. So I look forward to discussing it with you and everybody else who's joined us tonight.
I think when we talked the other day, and you talked about considering a career in literature and the arts, but you were going to be a critic. Is that right?
Yeah, correct. Not a poet or a writer. I don't think I'm creative enough for that. So I think my mind is more that of an engineer. Well, by the way, engineers and scientists can be very creative, but maybe in a more structured way, in a more formal way than artists. So I think I chose wisely given my my capabilities.
I think you did. And when you said the word critic the other day, it triggered in my mind a speech by Teddy Roosevelt, the Man in the Arena speech. Do you know that speech?
Actually, I do not.
Yeah. Okay. So he gave this in the Sorbonne on April 23rd in 1910. Mm-hmm. And I'll just, it's a very famous speech. And I'll just read a couple lines of it. It starts out with, "It is not the critic who counts." And see, it was when you said critic that triggered that memory in me. "Not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better." And it goes on and so forth. And he says, "The credit belongs to the man who's actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, and who strives valiantly." I won't go through the whole thing, but when you said critic, and then I looked at your bio and all the things you've done, I thought, you know, you made the right choice. You're the guy in the arena, you know? And we're so lucky to have you here tonight.
Thank you again. And I think it's important to recognize that one of the many things that make MIT unique is our strong desire to have an impact in the real world, right? We do research, but and there is a lot of value in doing research, almost like for research sake, very basic and so on, the pursuit of knowledge, et cetera. But I think it is important to use your words or the words of Roosevelt to be in the arena, right? To be right there where it matters and potentially having an impact on issues and opportunities that matter to people. So,
good, yeah. And so to complete the background story, you're married, you have two kids, they're both pursuing technical careers, one in biochem, one in physics. You are so lucky to do that.
I am, and I promise I didn't push them in that direction. They could pick entirely on their own. But yeah, great choice for them as well.
Good for you. Yeah, good for you. Let's talk about nuclear. You know, there's been a sea change with respect to nuclear in the past year or so. You know, and it's the sea change is reflecting the driving forces of decarbonization and electrification and energy security. And especially in the last 6 months, energy security, you know, maybe you're familiar with Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And at the very bottom level, he has all these basic needs that you have to you have to meet before you can go up. And energy security is one of those. You know, the West is now in a hybrid war with Russia. Russia has weaponized energy. And so, you know, it's really different than a year ago. In fact, I know you've got some slides in there on some of the stuff, but just this week, you know, on Tuesday, we saw Westinghouse and the Canadian company Cameco do a deal. Yesterday, I was at a conference where our good MIT friend Ernie Munez said that very concisely, one of our top three and most urgent needs is zero carbon firm power. And that's, you know, nuclear or hydro or geothermal, and there just isn't much space left for geothermal or hydro. So it's very topical.
It certainly is. And thanks for teeing it up. I think I'm going to hit on some of these points in my presentation. The piece of news that is really super recent, as you mentioned, just announced yesterday about Westinghouse is actually very significant, because you may or may not know the company Westinghouse, which is one of the historically strongest corporations working in this area, went bankrupt because of a couple of botched new nuclear construction projects roughly 5 or 6 years ago. And it was sold for about $1 billion. And the sale that was announced yesterday to a new set of owners and so on is $7.5 billion. So quite clear evaluation and recognition of the value of a company like that has grown dramatically. So yes, I'll hit on the, I'm going to call it the inflection point that I think we have seen in the past 18 months, roughly 2021, 2022 for nuclear. And it's driven by the things that you said, energy security, climate, obviously the desire for new economic opportunity and reducing inequalities, which is another third, it's a third very, very important issue. So
that's important too. Well, let me turn it over to you. And just one more shout out to our audience. Once again, please hoot and holler to put your questions in the Q&A box. And you're on.
All right, very good, Larry. So let's see if I can share the slides here. I assume you can see it. So the title is already announced prior, the future of nuclear energy, as we enter a new era. So this should move on. So let me just give you the punchline. I think, yes, I will argue that there is a lot of evidence that we have entered a new era for nuclear, but not surprisingly, there are potential risks. I think the new era, so to speak, could be short-lived if one of the following things happens: a major accident anywhere that turns people against nuclear the way that happened roughly 10 years ago, over 10 years ago at Fukushima, and or the nuclear industry repeats the debacle of the new construction projects both in the United States and Western Europe, which again we have seen over the past 10 years. Why do I call them a debacle? Because those projects were supposed to cost X and take Y to complete, and they cost three times X and taking two times Y to complete. So massive cost overrun, schedule delays, which have left a very sour taste in investors and so on. So if the industry cannot start to deliver new nuclear power plants on time and on budget, this new era could be very, very short-lived. But so let's take a big step back here and spend a few minutes talking about what I call the value proposition of nuclear energy in a low carbon world. Why do we even care about this technology now that we have a concern about carbon emissions and the climate change that comes from it? So this is an MIT presentation, and so they don't pay us at the end of the month unless we show some equations, some reactions, some math, and so on. So let's go back to basic. And I want to compare on this slide nuclear to two other energy sources that we've been using for over centuries to power our economy. The first, of course, is coal. And with coal at the heart of the technology, there is a combustion reaction. So you take coal itself, which is basically atoms of carbon plus oxygen, which you get from the atmosphere, and unfortunately creates CO2, which is why we don't particularly like coal anymore. And it gives you a certain unit of energy. I think it's something like 2 electron volt or 4 electron volt. For natural gas, quite similar. It's a chemical combustion. So the molecule in that case, CH4, again, oxygen, you get CO2 you don't like, some water, that's no problem. And then you get a little bit more energy. So on a per unit, on a per reaction basis, if you will, natural gas is a little bit more efficient than coal. And then you have nuclear fission, which is not a chemical reaction at all. It's a nuclear reaction. And in that case, you have a neutron, which is absorbed by a nucleus of uranium-235, so the isotope 235 of uranium. It splits into two halves, and there is a whole distribution of these, what we call fission products here. I just indicated as an example, rubidium-93 and cesium-141. You got a couple of extra neutrons that come out of this reaction. That's important because this reaction is basically self-sustaining. It's a chain reaction. And last piece of information here is the most important. You get 50 million units of energy. So compare these three reactions, one unit of energy, two units of energy, 50 million units of energy. So the energy density of the fuel, which in this case is uranium, is literally millions of times higher than what you have with fossil fuels. In addition, you note just from the reactions there is no CO2 emitted in this process. And so that's part of the value proposition. Now, this high energy intensity has some very profound implications on the way you run a power plant or a nuclear power plant compared to a traditional fossil fuel power plant. So take, for example, a gigawatt scale, 1,000 megawatt scale power plant. That's enough to power a city the size of Boston, roughly 750,000 other people. If you were to use coal for that particular power plant, you would need roughly 7,000 tons per day of coal. So if you've ever seen pictures or visited or driven past a coal fire plant, you probably notice that there is literally a mountain of coal sitting outside. And it's usually a railroad that brings in coal shipments on a daily basis because you need to feed the plant that much material per day in order to produce that much power. Situation is similar if you use natural gas. However, it's a gas, it's not solid, so you don't have a pile of gas sitting outside. But what you have is a pipeline that continuously feed, in this case, the calculation suggests 64 cubic meters of natural gas per second. That's an enormous amount of natural gas. So the power plant fueled by fossil fuels has to be continuously fueled. And that means that if you have an event, for example, a couple of times we had polar vortices up here in New England. A couple of years ago, we had one in Texas. Then the reliability of electricity supply can be disrupted because you no longer have the ability to supply that fuel continuously to the power plant. Contrast that with a nuclear power plant, which requires roughly 300 kilograms per day of natural uranium. And natural uranium has less than 1% uranium-235. Okay, so 300 kilograms per day, uranium is a fairly dense material, something that would sit basically on my desk here. So that's the amount of material that is required to power the city of Boston for a full day. The implication of this is that nuclear power plants don't have to be refueled continuously. In fact, they're refueled very infrequently, typically between 18 and 24 months. So every year and a half or 2 years, you shut down the nuclear reactor, open it up, pull out the spent fuel that becomes waste, famous or infamous nuclear waste. Then you reload, you load fresh fuel in it, and off you go for an additional 18 to 24 months. So again, very different energy source. Now, a question that we get often is, okay, we understand that the, you know, the fission reaction is carbon-free, but what about all the other activities that are required to build a nuclear power plant? So construction, the mining of the material and the fuel, the transportation of those materials, decommissioning, waste disposal, et cetera. So these life cycle greenhouse gas emission studies have been performed many times. The example that is shown here is from the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change. And what is shown here is the carbon intensity of different energy sources. So the carbon intensity here is defined as the grams or mass of CO2 emitted per kilowatt hour electricity generated. And not surprisingly, on the left, you have fossil fuels because they emit a lot of CO2 in operation. And then to the right, you have what we call low carbon. I prefer low carbon to zero carbon or carbon-free energy sources. And you can see that nuclear and wind basically are at the bottom of the scale. And then you have a little bit more carbon intensity for hydropower, solar, et cetera. But nuclear is indeed, everything included, is indeed the lowest or close to the lowest carbon intense energy source that we have. Another thing that is very important is land utilization, how much land is required to generate a certain amount of energy with different energy sources. And in this case, I'm comparing nuclear to renewables, in particular solar and wind. And so again, it boils down to that first slide that I show you. The energy density of nuclear is very, very high because there is so much energy in the fuel, and therefore the machine that actually uses that fuel doesn't have to be very big. And so to put some numbers here on the slide, you see nuclear operates typically with 90% or higher capacity factor. That means that if the plant is designed for, say, 1,000 megawatt, it gives you that that amount of energy for 90% of the time, on average 900 megawatt. And that translates roughly to a 2,300 megawatt per square kilometer in terms of land utilization. Now, solar and wind are great energy sources, and we need to push on this, on deploying as many of these clean energy sources as possible. But as a matter of fact, they have very low capacity factor. This is the issue of intermittency. The sun doesn't always shine, the wind doesn't always blow. And moreover, they are not very dense energy sources. And therefore, the amount of land required, or I should say the amount of power that you can get per unit land for solar is 6 megawatt per square kilometer. And for wind is roughly 1 megawatt per square kilometer. Although to be fair, in the case of wind, you can do a lot of things with the land in between the wind turbines. So, you know, the impact is a little bit less than solar. Another question that is of interest is how much material is required to build different power plants or power plants based on different energy sources. So what I'm referring here to is not the fuel itself that is used in the operation of the plant, but is really the construction material. So you see here cement, glass, concrete, steel, and other construction materials. And the figure of merit is tons of these materials per, in this case, terawatt hour of electricity generated. And so nuclear is shown on the right. It's again, very energy dense, which means not a lot of, even if the plants are large, it doesn't require a lot of materials for the amount of energy that you get out of those plants. And then perhaps surprisingly to some of you, you see solar, hydro, and wind on the other end being much more materials intensive. And needless to say, it does require energy to produce those materials. And there is a very real environmental impact because of all the mining that goes along with procuring those materials as well. Now, where does nuclear stand as of now? It already plays, frankly, a big role as part of our clean energy infrastructure. So what is shown here is the share of low carbon electricity. So this considers only nuclear, hydro, solar, wind, geothermal. It excludes oil, gas, and coal. So if you just restrict your sort of view to what is clean, carbon-free or low carbon, and you look at the share, then worldwide, a little bit less than 50% of our carbon-free or low-carbon electricity comes from hydro, about 30% from nuclear, and 20% or so from solar, wind, and geothermal, particularly solar and wind. But in the U.S. and in other important regions of the world, the situation is a little bit different. In the U.S., actually, we get roughly half of our carbon or low-carbon electricity from nuclear, and then roughly the same amount between solar, wind, and hydro. In China, they're very big on hydro. In the EU, the situation is similar to the United States. And then all the way to the right, I have the Republic of Korea, because I've given a similar presentation over there a few months back. And so I wanted to show them their numbers. And so there you see Korea relies heavily on nuclear, roughly 85% of their low carbon electricity is from nuclear and very minimal from the other low carbon energy sources. So those are just some examples. Now, what are the trends on a global scale? So we have nuclear capacity growing quite impetuously in China, India, Russia to a lesser extent, Middle East and Eastern Europe. We expect a big growth in the coming years. And we're seeing basically either stagnating or declining slightly in Western Europe, Japan for sure, and even the United States. So I'll get back to this in a moment, what the issues are. But first, I want to address a very important question. So the previous slide gives you a snapshot of where we are now. Now, a very legitimate question is, okay, I understand it provides, plays a big role. Do we need it going forward? And in particular, the question is do we need it to deeply decarbonize the power sector? And the emphasis here is on the word deeply. If you start with a grid that is pretty dirty because it relies heavily on coal and natural gas, it's actually fairly straightforward to reduce emissions somewhat. You know, you can switch from coal to natural gas that in itself reduces a little bit emissions. You can start deploying a little bit of renewables that will reduce emissions. But if you listen to climatologists for the power sector, and frankly, across all sectors of the economy, we cannot be content with 10 or 15 or 20% reduction in emissions. We actually have to go deep. And when I say deep, I really mean deep. It means something like 90, 95% of the emissions have to go. And so the question is, do we need nuclear? Does nuclear have a role when you're trying to do that deep decarbonization? Okay, so I would argue that the first step towards decarbonization is not to take a step back and actually allowing the emissions to rise. And that's exactly what happens when you shut down existing nuclear power plants. So the first priority is actually to preserve the existing fleet of nuclear power plants around the world. And this is because a license extension for those existing nuclear power plants is usually also a cost-efficient investment with respect to replacing them with emission equivalent alternatives. The numbers shown here are for the example of Spain. This is a study that we did several years ago, specifically for Spain, because there was an interest by a sponsor over there. And Spain has, at the moment, 7 nuclear reactors, roughly 1 gigawatt each, so 7 gigawatt of nuclear electricity. The license for these reactors is set to expire in the next decade, roughly. So the government of Spain and the utilities have the following dilemma. Do I allow those nuclear reactors to shut down, in which case they want to replace them with alternative energy sources with an emission equivalent mix, and so basically solar and wind plus storage that would be required to ensure that you can meet demand at any time? Or do you make the investment and extend the license of those seven reactors? So when you run the numbers here, you see the results. And so the scenarios that we looked at are, in green is the scenario called N7. That means you make the investment and renew the or extend the license of those reactors. And then in orange, you have four scenarios, one in which all that capacity is replaced with all solar, or all wind, or a mix of solar and wind, 25 and 75%, or the mirror image, 75, 25%, again, wind and solar. And so the bottom line of this analysis is what is highlighted over here. So if you make the investment and extend the license of those reactors, it's not cheap by any stretch of the imagination. It would add 35 euros per megawatt hour to the cost of electricity from those plants. But compare that to the cost of the other four scenarios. The best you could do in the other four scenarios is the one all the way to the right, which I think is 75% wind and 25% solar, and it would be roughly twice the cost of maintaining the nuclear reactors. So in the case of Spain, and we believe this applies almost uniformly, if you have existing nuclear power plants, keep them on. I want to make sure of a message that will come across, I hope, loud and clear throughout the presentation. This is not to say that it's either nuclear or renewables. The right approach is you keep your nuclear power plants and you add the renewables so that you start to make progress toward that deep decarbonization. And as I'll show you in the next slide, you probably want to also build new nuclear, not just preserving the existing one, but moving them forward with a larger share of nuclear. So this, I promise, is the most complicated slide that I'm going to have, but it's an important one. So allow me to take a couple of minutes to deconstruct it for you. So at MIT, we developed and validated a tool. It's called GenX, that essentially simulates the optimal generation mix in power markets. What does that mean? We take a region of the world, in this case, that I'm going to discuss here, is a very populous region around Beijing in China. The tool requires as input the hourly electricity demand, how much electricity is needed at any given hour throughout the year. So 8,760 entries there. It also takes as input the hourly weather patterns, how much wind and solar can I expect at any given time throughout the year. And then it takes in as input the cost, capital, operation, and maintenance fuel for all the power plants, including backup and energy storage, that you might have on your grid. And finally, it takes into account how quickly, what we call ramp up rates, how quickly the power the power output of power plant can go up and down to respond to demand changes. It crunches all these numbers and it gives you an optimal generation mix. And when you hear the word optimal, it means something is either minimized or maximized. And in this case, what's minimized is the average generation cost. So if you can see my cursor, look at the y-axis on this graph, the figure of merit here is the average generation cost, dollars per megawatt hour in that market. Okay, we can run this tool for different scenarios. And so a scenario might, for example, exclude the use of nuclear, and that would be in blue in this graph. Or another one could include the use of nuclear at some nominal cost. And then another one could include the use of nuclear at, say, an arbitrary 25% reduction cost. And we can then run those scenarios. Now you have to pay attention to the x-axis here, for different constraints, for different targets of decarbonization. And so currently, the world average is about 500 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. And as I mentioned a minute ago, we need to go down 95%, which means, in fact, the target ought to be 50 grams per kilowatt hour or even lower. So now please look at the results there. And you can see that the scenarios that exclude nuclear have a exponentially increasing average generation cost as you drive down that decarbonization target. Whereas the two other scenarios that allow nuclear to be part of the mix, they tend to have a more stable average generation cost. Now, why does that happen? Well, it's shown over here, if you can read it. What is shown here is actually the install capacity think about this as the amount of equipment, the amount of stuff that you have to install on the grid in order to meet demand under these different scenarios that I just mentioned. And the four data points that you see there are for the scenarios without nuclear. And what you can see is that the amount of installed capacity that is required to meet demand as you drive down the decarbonization target increases exponentially. And what you're deploying, if you can see the legend there, is a lot of battery storage, a lot of solar PV, and then a lot of onshore wind. And so it's the aggregate cost of this massive overcapacity that really increases the average generation cost. So what we find here is that the optimal mix as a balanced share of nuclear and intermittent or variable renewables like solar and wind. And they actually work together very nicely to keep the average cost down. Okay, so a few words on what is the support for nuclear at the moment. And this is where we get basically to the title, that we enter a new era or not. So in the United States, there is indeed growing support for nuclear to play a role in a low carbon world. This comes from many different directions at the moment. My favorite, probably climatologists. They're not energy technology experts, but they do understand the magnitude of the challenge that is facing us in terms of decarbonizing our energy system. And you know, some prominent climatologists, including MIT's own Kerry Manuel, come out in many instances saying that there is essentially no credible path to climate stabilization that would exclude a substantial role for nuclear power. Very interesting also on the political spectrum, both the Democrats and the Republicans, we know that they disagree on many different things, on almost everything. One thing that by some miracle they agree is their support for nuclear energy. Of course, they come to that conclusion from very different angles. For the Democrats, it's indeed all about the potential role that nuclear can play in decarbonizing our energy system. For the Republicans, it's more about energy security, more about business opportunities for nuclear companies, U.S. nuclear companies, as well as the ability of the U.S. to regain technology leadership in nuclear on the global scale. Then you have high net worth individuals, such as Bill Gates and others, that have actually invested a significant amount of money of their own in new nuclear companies. Bill Gates' company is called TerraPower, and they just signed a year ago a contract with DOE and with a customer in Kemmerer in Wyoming for a first of a kind unit of their technology. And so there is growing support in the US. Now, 2021, 2022 was really an inflection point for nuclear. And I'm gonna go over this long list here, a little bit tedious, but I think it's important you appreciate the number of either changes or things that have happened that are pushing in the direction of support for nuclear. So the invasion of Ukraine, as sad as it has been, has certainly shown that fossil fuels are in the long term not sustainable. And the way we've seen it, at least in the past 8 months, has been a price of fossil fuels that has gone up very, very dramatically. We also had COP26, that's a big powwow for all governments and NGOs, got together in Glasgow last November. And of course, nuclear was not the center stage, but it was one of the technologies that for the first time, frankly, in this COP series was prominently discussed and pushed. And then we had the so-called taxonomy or energy technology taxonomy of the European Union, where nuclear and sadly also natural gas have been included as transition technologies and therefore suitable for investment in the EU. But we also see climate policies that endorse the inclusion of nuclear in individual states, not just at the continental level in Europe. China is committed to a massive nuclear expansion, 150 gigawatt within the next 15 years. That's nothing short of extraordinary. But they do have the capability of doing this. They've proven it's one of the countries that has been building new nuclear power plants more reliably in terms of cost and schedule. And they are on that path of actually passing the United States to be the largest user of nuclear energy. There was presidential election in South Korea. South Korea, after the accident in Japan, Fukushima, had announced a future sort of a progressive phase out of nuclear. The current this year's election has put in place a new government, and a new administration, I should say, and that administration is very much in favor of nuclear. So they basically canceled the nuclear phase out. And so now they're talking openly about building new nuclear power plants in South Korea. Even Japan, as painful as the recovery from the accident of Fukushima has been, the new government has committed to the restart of many idle nuclear power plants, and there is their talk for new builds as well. And then in Europe, which is very interesting, it's almost like a checkerboard of different energy policies, and some countries are fiercely opposed to nuclear and others are in favor. The ones that have active programs that already have nuclear, that they're building more, are France, Finland, the Netherlands, the UK, Poland, Czech Republic, Hungary, Romania, and a couple of others that have nuclear potentially on their radar. There have been some market-driven decisions to build new nuclear power plants in Canada and the United States, including the one based on Bill Gates' TerraPower technology in Wyoming. And there was a very momentous announcement by Dow Chemical and X-Energy. X-Energy is a new nuclear company just a couple of months ago or so about using nuclear heat, so not just electricity, for some chemical plants on the Gulf Coast of the United States. So a new use of nuclear to decarbonize a sector that is not the traditional power sector, but equally important in this case, chemical plants. There is a lot of money for nuclear and other clean energy sources in the Inflation Reduction Act and the infrastructure bill that have been approved over the past few months by the US government. And typically they come in the form of tax credits, either production tax credits for the megawatt hour produced by nuclear and other clean energy sources, or investment tax credits. So this would be for new plants that would be deployed in the coming years. And then I couldn't resist mentioning the borderline miraculous decision of the California legislature on September 1st to extend the Diablo Canyon nuclear power plant. And again, a lot of interesting discussions there, but the desire not to take a giant step back in terms of decarbonization certainly played an important role there. Okay, so for the first time, as I mentioned already a couple of times, there is also interest from private capital. By my estimate, at the tune of about $4 billion per year at the moment. Each dock year represents an advanced nuclear project in North America. There is over 70 of them. Just to be honest and clear with you, I think 90% are probably, maybe a little bit less than 90%, are probably not very credible in terms of technical capabilities or even financial backing, but roughly a dozen are quite credible, and maybe half of those will actually see the commercialization. And some projects are already on their way, as I'll tell you later on. So again, this is a good situation, and what gives us reason for optimism is that for the first time in decades, this is not all government driven, but there is serious private sector interest there. I'm going to skip this and this other one. You'll have the slides and you can go through here if you're interested. This is just a long list of initiatives and both at the federal state level as well as the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to essentially streamline the approval for new nuclear power plants and support them financially and all of that. So again, it's just some resources for your benefit. Okay, so far a lot of good news, but there is no shortage of issues. And so let me tell you what the central problem is. And I read through your some of the questions that were submitted prior to the seminar here. And so I know that you have questions about what about safety, what about waste. We can get to that in the Q&A. But the main problem, really, the reason why we're not building hundreds of these nuclear power plants at the moment is not waste and it's not safety. The problem really is that the current business model for new nuclear is economically unattractive. That's very true in the US and Europe. The situation is quite different in Asia. So first of all, what do I mean by business model? Well, traditionally, nuclear power plants take a long time for testing and licensing, particularly if it's a new design, if it's some kind of innovation in the design of the reactor and the design of the nuclear power plant. Takes roughly a decade just to test it and license it. Then construction starts, and the construction is based on a sprawling construction site. You see an image there, typically with thousands of workers. And if you have companies that know what they're doing, it could take 4 or 5 years to build it. But we've seen very, very massive delays in the US and Western Europe, a factor of two, factor of three longer, so 10, 15 years. And needless to say, when you have so much capital at risk, billions of dollars invested, a delay of a factor of 5 years, 10 years on the schedule, it means that you're going to pay a lot more interest on your loan, and that really adds up quite quickly. Not only that, but you're also delaying the generation of revenue, which of course adds to the misery. Now, when it's all said and done, these traditional nuclear power plants are quite awesome. You know, you're talking about 1,000 megawatt on a fairly small piece of land, as we discussed earlier. But they're connected to the electric grid, and the electric grid is essentially a commodity market. It's very hard to make money on the grid. So this model has got to change. And one way that we looked at this in the Future Nuclear Energy Study that we completed a few years back was comparison of the nuclear industry with other important industries in terms of the size of the system that's at the heart of that industry. Again, traditionally for nuclear power plants, is a large plant. Factory fabrication or construction site base. So either stick built or sort of mass produced. And once again, traditionally for nuclear is very much stick built at a construction site. Number three, testing and licensing. Is it long? Is it short? Does the licensing of a new design require the proof of a safety case or not? And then lastly, is this machine producing a high return product, a high value added product, or a commodity? And again, electrons typically are commodities. So when you compare nuclear to the other industries, at least traditional nuclear to the other industry, you see that it's not unique in any one category, but is the only technology that has negative attributes across all four. It's almost like, that's why I call it perfect storm of unfortunate attributes. So historically, what this has translated to is a very long and costly innovation cycle. So if you have an idea for a new reactor that has some interesting features that will allow you to do something different from the past, traditionally that's taken essentially 2 decades and cost roughly $10 billion to bring that innovation to commercial stage and then finally start to make some money. So from an investment point of view, unless you're a government, vertically integrated, that has that kind of stability and horizon for decision making and seeing the project through 20 years and that kind of power in terms of spending $10 billion, et cetera, this is not a very attractive proposition. So what I and others have advocated for is a change in the what I call the deployment paradigm. So what do I mean by that? Well, this new paradigm is going to have three elements. First, we need to focus more on small and serial manufacturer systems. So the model that is alluded to there would be jet engines. If you think about jet engines, they are like small power plants. And in fact, they produce mechanical work that is used to generate thrust that then drives the airplane forward. And they are of a size and a complexity that allows them to be built in factories, so very efficient. And so we would advocate that nuclear reactors have to become more like that as opposed to those big cathedral-like structures that you see at the moment. We've accelerated testing and licensing, and the key to accelerating testing and licensing is to have a safety characteristics of the reactor itself that allow you to do licensing by testing. In other words, deploying a full-scale unit, a prototype, call it a demonstration unit or whatever you want to call it, and intentionally put it through a series of abnormal situations, call them transients or accidents, and verify that the system behaves according to behaves benignly and according to how it was designed. And so that we think would provide a lot of confidence in the regulator to be able to approve that technology without going through, a very lengthy program, say 10 years of testing and then licensing. And then the third element of the paradigm is to produce not only electricity for the grid, although the grid is here to stay, and so you will want clean electrons for the grid, but also look at higher value-added energy products, where nuclear energy products could basically sell at a premium. So please keep in mind these three elements of the paradigm, because now I'm going to spend a few minutes on each of this one. So the first is this idea of smaller reactors, smaller machines that reduces the complexity and number of nuclear grade systems and structures. I think the industry in the West has embraced this quite a bit. The first benefit is that you reduce the cost and time for design and engineering, the one-off work that has to be performed prior to even deploying the first unit. If you have less to design, if you have less complex systems to design, that reduces the cost. It could dramatically reduce the cost and schedule for that all-important first-of-a-kind unit, prototype, or demo. And the success of that first project is key, particularly to attract investors, and then also to provide confidence in the regulator and the public that the technology works. And you can do that if the system is smaller, much reduced cost. So just to give you an idea of some scales in terms of power output, cost, and typical schedule, the traditional plants are what we call large light water reactors. They're shown on the left. So these are big beasts, you know, between 1 gigawatt, 1.6 gigawatt, a lot of energy. They cost a lot of money. $3 to $10 billion. That's a big range, and it's a big range because in some countries they're very good at building these large plants, and so you're in the $3 billion. In some countries like the US and Western Europe, we've been very bad at building them in the past 10, 15 years, and so it's closer to $10 billion. At $10 billion, this is now very competitive, and it takes either 5 or 10 years for the same reason I just said. Some companies are good, some countries are good at building them, others are not. Then you have the second category in the middle. Small modular reactors and advanced modular reactors. I apologize for the acronyms, one. Number two, for the name. Some of these names don't mean much to people outside my community, but I'm trying to use names that are consistent with what is used, to describe these technologies. So these are smaller. They're smaller now by an order of magnitude. So again, depending on the design, you could have either 70 or 300 megawatts, so significantly smaller. The expectation is that they will cost dramatically less, $1 to $3 billion, again, depending on the design, who builds it, et cetera. And again, the theory is that this could be deployed in 3 to 5 years. Realistically, I think the first units might be closer to 5 years, but then as you build more and more and you learn, probably you go down to 3 years. And then you have the last category all the way to the right. And here is where you really sort of miniaturized and brought down the scale of nuclear reactors to a very, very small scale. So the power output here could be between 2 and 10 megawatts of electricity. This would cost way less than $100 million. We estimate roughly $30 million for a 10-megawatt machine. And it would take months, not years, to build them in factories. And they would be basically mass-produced the same way that you produce jet engine. So I have encircled these two categories, the small modular reactors, nuclear batteries, because I want to tell you a little bit more about this. These are the more interesting products that at the moment people are interested in. So let me start with an example of a small modular reactor. What you see actually in the middle is a very large 1600 megawatts traditional large water reactor that was designed by GE, General Electric. And what they did, they dramatically simplified this plant. They also reduced the power output from 1600 megawatt to 300 megawatt. And you see the result on the right. That's not the whole plant. That's just what we call the nuclear island. It's basically the reactor and the surrounding structures. But the bottom line is that they were able to reduce the volume, the physical volume of the plant, by 90%, so a factor of 10 lower. And what is important, by 50% per unit energy generated, and by over 50% less concrete, which is a material that costs a lot of money, also per unit energy generated. So the expectation is that this will be simpler to build and ultimately cheaper to produce cheaper electricity. But part of the value proposition of this approach is also that the technology is not radically different. In other words, you have repackaged, re-engineered systems and materials and fuels that you already know of. And so the technology maturity of this small modular reactor is actually quite high. So the target overnight construction cost for these plants would be $2,500 per kilowatt. They won't hit that one on the first units, but I think it's realistic that over 4 or 5 units, they will actually get down there. And a levelized cost of electricity of less than $50 per megawatt hour, which for low carbon firm capacity is actually would be pretty darn good. It's the ideal size for replacing coal and natural gas plant because those plants tend to be in the few hundred megawatts as opposed to thousands of megawatts. And so you can slot in a nuclear reactor and replace a coal plant, for example. They can be deployed in small increments. We already talked about the investment. They're designed for frequent load following. There is a lot of variability on the grid these days from both demand as well as generation because of intermittency. And to be a good season of the grid, you have to have that ability to follow the load. And so these plants are being designed with that capability from the beginning. From a security point of view, they typically are placed below grade. So they're not deep underground, but below grade. And that reduces the number of areas and components and structures that have to be actively guarded, and also it makes it less prone to, terrorist attacks and things of that type. I already mentioned based on proven technology, and Western suppliers are in the lead. So this particular design I'm showing here is by General Electric Hitachi, but you also have other designs by NuScale, Rolls-Royce, Electricité de France in France, Altec, etc. In the category of advanced modular reactors, still order of 100 megawatts or so, this is an interesting design. It's called a high temperature gas reactor. This actually radically changes materials, fuels, the components. Nothing here looks the same because here the coolant is not water, like in the previous example I gave you, but it's helium. And the fuel is not the traditional pellets of uranium dioxide within rods, metallic rods, but it's actually a pebble, a graphite pebble, which is laden with tiny little TRISO particles. You see an image on the top right here. And within those particles, you have uranium, which is your nuclear fuel. And within that fuel, you have the fusion reaction, which produces the heat that then you use. So quite different. The value proposition for this design or for this class of designs is that they typically operate at very high temperature, much higher than traditional light water reactors. And so 550, 750 degrees C. Why is that important? For two reasons. First, the second law of thermodynamics says that you can then have a higher efficiency of conversion of heat to electricity. So in this case, it would be about 40, 45%. And number two, you have a bunch of customers that actually want heat for industrial processes, and they want heat at those temperatures. And so I already mentioned the announcement by Dow Chemical with X Energy, which is one of the vendors for this type of reactors, that a couple of months ago, they said, well, we want to use these reactors for chemical plants because those chemical plants require heat at relatively high temperature. They're also walk away safe, which is a very unfortunate way to say that operators don't have to intervene. They don't have to do anything. If there is an accident, the plant basically puts itself in a safe state without any external intervention. This particular technology has been is in operation now in China. It has been for a couple of years. Western suppliers like X Energy that I already mentioned and a couple of others that are listed here are reasonably well positioned. So we're likely to see some of these machines in operation soon in the US as well. Now, what innovations could make a difference on cost? So I already mentioned the fact that these are smaller and that's smaller, simpler, that's expected to reduce cost. But there are other things that you can do to reduce cost. The first and sort of easiest is to basically standardize and then deploy multiple identical units at the same site. If you do that, it's the same workforce that builds the first unit, the second unit, the third unit, the fourth units. And there is very strong evidence that the cost from unit one to unit three to unit four to unit five, et cetera, comes down very nicely. So if you need the capacity, if you need a large capacity at one site, eventually it's much better to build multiple identical at that site as opposed to scattering them at different sites. Advanced concrete solutions. Reinforced concrete is usually a big chunk of the cost of new nuclear power plants. And reinforced concrete is a very labor intensive and very material intensive material or structure, aggregate material. And so there are ways in which you can reduce the amount of labor and the amount of material involved in erecting reinforced concrete structures. And one example that is shown here at the bottom left is the use of steel plate composites, essentially steel boxes that are built in factories, very high efficiency environments. And then they're brought to the site, they're welded typically by a robot. And then you pour the concrete, the cement paste, the concrete in between, and then you're done as opposed to having to create a rebar cage and a formwork and then stripping it off, et cetera. So these solutions for advanced concrete are being used already by other industries. It's simply, so to speak, a matter of bringing it into codes and standards that are suitable for nuclear plants. A little bit more creative, you could integrate nuclear reactors in floating platforms and barges. this has been done. It's not just a pipe dream. The image that you see up there on the right is a power barge with two nuclear reactors. It's a Russian design that has been in operation 5 years in a town called Pevek on the north slope of Siberia. So this was built in St. Petersburg. It was fueled at a different base in Russia, and then it was floated up to the town. So the idea here is that you build them in shipyards as opposed to build them at stick built them on site. And again, that's expected to reduce cost. And in this case, this is a mobile power plant, so you can take it to a different site if that site no longer needs the energy. And then last but not least, everybody's favorite, modular construction. So instead of bringing raw materials and individual components to the site and then stick build the plant at the site, you pre-assemble large modules and then you bring those modules to the site and you connect them a little bit more like Lego style. So a combination of all of these or any of this is expected to reduce cost. What's interesting is that this is applicable to all new nuclear reactor designs. You don't have to pick, you know, one particular reactor design or the other. It should help with all of them. And some of the solutions I mentioned have been adopted in other industries with dramatic cost reductions between 20 and 50% in overnight construction costs. So again, I think the industry should take a good look at this. So let me switch to the to that last category of nuclear reactors, the what I call the nuclear batteries, the miniaturized, the tiny ones. So what is a nuclear battery? Well, I already said it's a micro reactor. It's a small reactor. It generates, let's say, between 1 and 20 megawatt of heat and or electricity. We said carbon free because it's nuclear. Interestingly, they're designed to be dry cooled. So there is no need for water, even for the ultimate heat sink. So you don't need to be close to a river, the ocean, a lake, et cetera. They can be in the middle of the desert. You're using air, atmospheric air for cooling, for removing the heat. The waste heat from the reactor, from the plant itself. Standardized reactor design, mass producing factories, which you can do because of the size and complexity of these things. Transportable in ISO in standard containers. So you see here an example of how one such nuclear battery could be brought to a site. In this case, it would entail three containers. The first on the left is the nuclear battery itself, is the reactor. Then you have one power conversion container. Then you have instrumentation and control container. So very different model of deploying nuclear energy with this approach. It's meant to be a plug and play connection. So between days and weeks from the time you bring in these containers and the time you actually get the energy. Semi-autonomous operation, you cannot afford to have dozens of operators because this is a system that only puts out, you know, a few megawatts. So you can't afford to have 10 people there 24/7, but you can easily design this to be a semi-autonomous. And so you have a remote monitor, not a remote control, but a remote monitor offsite that basically keeps an eye, but this basically is a reactor that operates itself, and maybe every day you have someone that comes in and does some maintenance or some monitoring or some checkings. It's a energy source that can produce energy on demand for say 5 to 10 years continuously. And at the end of that period, it has to be refueled. And here comes the other innovation. It's not refueled on site. It's actually shipped back in one piece to a central facility where it's open up, defueled, refueled, refurbished, and either sent back to the same site or to a different site. So that's also why we call them batteries, is because what we have in mind is a fleet model of identical and interchangeable batteries. The customer shouldn't care whether they get unit A, B, or C, because they all look the same. The implication of this offsite refueling approach is that the customer does not have to, or the user of this technology does not have to either handle or store radioactive material on site. And so the handling of nuclear waste here becomes much simpler because it's all done in a centralized fashion to begin with. It's not done at each individual user site. I already mentioned energy density of nuclear. Here you see this spelled out for a nuclear battery. That little green rectangle you can barely see is a 10 megawatt nuclear battery, and that's how it compares to a 10 megawatt nominal, 10 megawatt community solar or wind turbine. And also for these technologies, at least for the time being, the US suppliers are in the lead. And so Westinghouse, which was mentioned in the introduction, also BWXT and X Energy are big players for this transportable micro reactors. Okay, so what would you couple these nuclear batteries to? Well, you would couple it to modularize and mobilize advanced production technologies, as we call. So what is advanced production, advanced industrial production? Essentially any process technology that can be modularized and mobilized. So you would deploy this in increments, in small increments, powered by nuclear batteries, and it would become a plug and play with minimal civil work. Again, not a lot of reinforced concrete, not a lot of excavation, no construction sites that would match revenue to debt quickly, and therefore also minimize the risk of underutilization of large facilities. So to be a little bit more concrete, in this domain, when you hear the word modular and mobilized, what do we mean? Well, you have four examples here. If you're into data centers, you can either go with a big monolithic data centers as shown there on the left, $400 million over 2 years, or you can deploy within a month on-site data centers. Of course, which requires 50 megawatt from the grid or diesel or from those nuclear batteries. Now, of course, if you want a higher capacity data centers, you need to deploy more of those containerized data centers. But again, here, the emphasis about the model is how do you actually deploy them, how quickly and how precisely you can follow the demand as opposed to building something massive at the beginning and then wait for the demand to be there or the capacity to be absorbed by market. The same goes for things like pharmaceutical facilities or even agriculture or even hydrogen production. You can either go with a central facility with that looks like a refinery that requires a lot of money and a lot of cost, or you can go with mobilized and modularized production. So when you combine these two things, when you combine nuclear batteries with this advanced modular production, you have what I would call a game changer. The example shown here could be a site in some state that is struggling with the energy transition, Wyoming, West Virginia, Alaska, all traditionally very fossil fuel based, and they're looking for ways to decarbonize. And the combination of nuclear batteries with this advanced production is a way to decarbonize that does not punish them economically. So let me explain what I'm showing here. This could be a site where you have an iron mine, and you're going to deploy one or more nuclear batteries at that site, and you're going to have electricity that can allow you to do electric mining for that iron mine. That would give you the iron ore, which you can then use in, say, a molten oxide electrolysis. For those of you who are following the innovations and the new technologies coming out of MIT, you might have heard of Boston Metal. So it's a way to basically create steel with no CO2 emissions. It uses electricity and heat as input. Now, if that heat and electricity are not carbon-free, of course, you have CO2 emissions. But in this case, that heat and electricity would come from the nuclear battery, so they would be carbon-free. And then you have clean steel. And instead of selling clean steel commodity to the market, also co-located at the same site, you could have modular manufacturing and assembly. And actually, what you're going to end up selling to the market is finished steel products, which command a much higher premium. And so your margins are going to be better. Your value added is going to be much higher. So at the very high level, what are the features of this system? Well, first, you have eliminated really the need for grids and pipelines. The infrastructure here is all co-located. You don't need to bring in the energy from long distance for transmission lines. You don't need to bring in materials or fuels from long distance because you got everything at one site. It shortens the market chains, so you don't have a lot of middlemen. Essentially, your margins are going to be larger if what you produce is finished products. It allows for incremental provisioning, and I'll show you what I mean about that in the next slide. And last but really not least, you can say with a straight face that your finished products that you're selling to the market are carbon free without relying to any carbon offsets or credits or anything like that. They truly are carbon free because all your energy input is carbon free. All right, so let me explain what I mean by incremental provisioning. This is a very important concept. So the idea here is what I mentioned earlier. You can precisely follow your demand by deploying capacity as you need it, not all up front. And therefore, it reduces the amount of capital that you put at risk at the beginning. It also reduces the amount of interest that you're paying on that initial capital. So the example that I want to show you here is in this plot. So we did a model for actually a fairly commoditized steel that sells for $800 per metric ton. It's cold rolled steel. So this is not even high-end steel. And we had three curves here. So let me explain to you what these curves are. So the gray curve is a generic demand factor. So is how much of this steel you're going to need over the years. By the way, the x-axis here is time in years. And so it's generic in a sense that you start with a ramp up of what you need, and then there is some kind of economic crisis that reduces the demand for that steel, and then it picks up again and it stays more or less constant. And then you have the two other curves. One is blue and one is yellow. So let me start with the yellow curve at the bottom. That's the traditional approach. You know that you want X ultimately capacity, so you're going to deploy a large steel mill that is able or is capable to give you X. Now, reasonably that, or realistically, that steel mill is going to cost you a lot of money. So your cash flow, which is shown here in yellow, is going to go negative very quickly. And then with time, you're finally going to start to make money. And in this particular simulation, it takes 15 years before you start to, before you become cash flow positive. And so you start to actually make money. And contrast that with the blue approach, which is what I just described essentially, is this incremental provisioning. So you deploy a nuclear battery with a modularized steel mill that uses the nuclear battery. And then you deploy another one when it's needed, and another one, and another one, and another one. And basically your cash flow here never goes negative. Now, in reality, if I were to show you what happens in year one, it does go negative a little bit because you do have a little bit of investment that you have to make right up front for that first unit. But it clearly looks much better. And if you run these same simulations, not for a commodity steel, $800 per metric ton, but for a high-end or mid-end steel that sells for, say, $1,600 or $2,000 per metric ton, the curves look even more attractive. So the point here is that incremental provisioning allows you to actually be profitable very, very quickly. So this should be attractive. And it's very robust also with respect to the cost of the energy input. This approach potentially applies across all sectors of the economy. We talk about mining sites, high-end metals there. You have a time arrow here that basically shows the order, the likely order in which these applications will be tackled first. And you start with the applications that have the largest margin potential or early need. And so military bases, microgrids, remote mining sites, indoor farming. We talk about metals, ceramics, glass. And then down a little bit more commoditized, data centers, maybe desalination. And then here, flood protection, so pumps, district heating, futuristic, maybe space installations, freight shield propulsion, existing factories and chemical plants, biofuels, hydrogen electrolyzer, et cetera. The reason why I'm excited about this is because, well, this goes way beyond the electric grid. If you recognize on these two slides, you almost have every possible sector of the economy. And so the electric grid, as good as and important as it is, only represents about one quarter of our global greenhouse gas emissions. Whereas the kind of applications that I'm showing you here represent over three quarters of greenhouse emissions. So if we were able to decarbonize, this would be really, really good. So let me come to the end of the presentation. I got two more slides. One on safety. So I already mentioned the key to accelerating the testing and licensing of these new reactors is an extraordinarily robust safety profile. And what do I mean by that without getting too technical? It's a combination of inherent attributes, things like the materials that you choose for cooling the reactor, or the physical form of the fuel itself and how well it retains the fission products, which are the radioactivity basically produced by the fission reaction, or the high thermal capacity of the core, the ability of the material of the reactor to absorb energy without allowing the temperature to go up, and things of that type. So those are what we call inherent safety attributes. If you combine those with engineered safety systems, so valves, pipes, heat exchangers that are passive, that means they don't require any pumps or any emergency diesel generators, et cetera, then you are able to achieve the basic nuclear safety functions, things like rapidly shut down the reactor itself, provide adequate cooling after shutdown, preventing the radioactivity release into the biosphere. You're able to achieve those functions without any external intervention. So again, this is what people sometimes call walk away safe, which really means the plant, the system puts itself in an end state automatically by itself. It doesn't require any external intervention. Why is that important? It's important for two reasons. First, because accidents like Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, Fukushima are eliminated by design. That is not to say that you cannot have accidents any machine that is designed by human beings can fail in some ways. But what I'm telling you is that the consequences of those failures are much, much more benign than what we've seen in the past. Okay, and so that's an important consideration. And the second consequence, which is even more important, is that the emergency planning zone, which is an area surrounding the reactor, surrounding the plant, excuse me, in which if you live or work there, you need to be trained periodically so that you know how to respond to an emergency, et cetera, that now becomes limited to site boundary. In traditional nuclear power plants, the area, the emergency planning zone, is an extension of roughly 10 miles around one of those large nuclear power plants. So people live there, work there, no problem. But if you do that, then you are in a, you have to be trained periodically. You need to know what to do if there is an accident, if there is an emergency. Now, with this new technology, that emergency planning zone is going to be shrunk to the site boundary, which would mean a few meters, 100 meters or whatever it is, where the reactors are located, and that's it. So the implication of this in terms of public acceptance, we think that are going to be very, very important. Okay, I'm going to leave you with this. This is a list of actual, what I call real serious new construction projects in North America. There is several of them. I don't expect you to remember or recognize any of these acronyms or names here, but suffice it to say that there is a good diversity of technologies that are being tested in North America at the moment. So we have those SMRs, those small modular reactors, a couple of them with schedule 2028, 2029 for commercial operation. We have a couple of those advanced modular reactors that don't use water as a coolant, so a little bit more exotic, again, in the 2028, 2029 timeline. And then we have those nuclear batteries or micro reactors, as some people call them, which are a much, much faster trajectory. So here you're looking at 2023 next year for a tiny reactor marvel at the Idaho National Site, a 5 megawatt machine actually being designed for the U.S. Army in 2024, 2025, and then a commercial nuclear battery, also 5 megawatt in 2025. So again, there is a lot going on, and it's sort of an exciting time in that because we think that a good subset of these projects will actually see, that we'll get to the finish line, and this will become commercial technologies available to do all the good things that we want them to do. So takeaway messages. So nuclear is enjoying strong bipartisan support in the US for the first time in many years, and not just in Congress, but as I mentioned, broadly industry, policymakers, and all of that. But building new nuclear power plants is economically challenging. That's true in the US and Western Europe, is not true in other parts of the world. So those large plants are continue to be built and will continue to be built for the foreseeable future. But I don't see that happening in the US and Western Europe because the recent failures of the new construction projects in our countries have left a very sour taste in the investors. So cost reduction opportunities in the US, we talked a lot about this, may come from smaller, simpler, more serially manufactured nuclear systems. We've accelerated testing and licensing. And then I spent a little bit of time telling you about these small portable nuclear batteries. And what excites me about this is the potential to decarbonize and transform economically every sector of the economy, not just the power grid. So with that, I'll stop, and I'm happy to take any questions that you might have. So I guess, Larry, the ball is back to you.
Jacopo, that was just fabulous, comprehensive. You know, it's always fun getting a drink of water out of a fire hose, to use the MIT cliche. So we have a huge number of questions. There were 4 pages of questions submitted before we started this afternoon, and we got a whole bunch more in the Q&A. So we're pressed on time here. So I'm going to pick what I think are some of the best ones, some of the most comprehensive ones, and let you have a crack at them. One of them is waste. One of them has to do with nuclear waste. How are we going to solve this issue? What happens to the spent fuel? Do we need Yucca Mountain or someplace like it? And should we be reprocessing this fuel? What's your thought?
Yeah, great question. And it was in the list of questions that were submitted prior to the talk. So I was ready and I prepared a couple of slides. So please bear with me, more slides coming. It's such an important topic, right? Because it's a classic objection to nuclear. Okay, I get it. We need it for decarbonization. It's I believe it's safe. Maybe you can make it cheap. What about waste? Okay, so first, a very, very brief tutorial. What do we mean by waste? It's that spent fuel that comes out of the reactor, right? So the fuel goes in, it's fresh, it's uranium. But when you have fission, by definition, fission breaks all these nuclei of uranium-235, you got those fission products. Those fission products are radioactive, and they stay radioactive for a long period of time. So that's what we call the nuclear waste. So once when the reactor is refueled, that spent fuel, that nuclear waste comes out, and it's typically put in storage pools, you see an image here, for 3 to 5 years. The current practice is actually closer to 3 years, okay? During that period, that radioactivity naturally decays off quite nicely. And so after 3 years, you're able to transfer these spent fuel or the spent fuel assemblies into dry casks. So I'm going to show you an image of the dry cask in a second, but first I want to point to the bottom of this slide where you can see this beautiful landscape up in Maine. This was the site of the main Yankee nuclear power plant, which operated, I think, until the mid-1990s or something like that. And then it was shut down. It has been completely decommissioned, except for two pieces of the old plant that you can barely see there. So let me describe. One on the right is the switchyard. They decided to keep basically that infrastructure as part of the electric grid. So that is non-nuclear. And then the second is what I really want to focus on. If you can see my cursor here, is what I call the parking lot. And so what is that? Well, that's basically the spent fuel, which after that power plant operated for two or three decades, I think, you have 80 such dry casks. And now I can show you what they look like. These are the dry casks, inside of which you have that, that spent fuel. And so the plan in the US since 1982, I want to say, with the Nuclear Waste Act, was that eventually these dry casks are going to be taken to a central location, and that central location then becomes a permanent repository. And the location was chosen to be Yakima Mountain in Nevada. Now, because that whole process was so badly mismanaged from a political point of view, it is my opinion, I think the opinion of many in my community, is that the Yakima Mountain repository is never going to happen, for the simple reason that the state of Nevada doesn't want it. So at the moment, these dry casks, which are very, very safe to handle, you can see here, people can go up to that, touch them, spend an afternoon there, not that there is anything particularly exciting to do. Very well shielded and dry, which means they're cooled by air. They can stay there for a very long time, but at the moment they are just sitting outside, that's why I call it parking lot, of these nuclear power plants, whether they're operating or decommissioned, they're staying there. Eventually, they have to go to a central facility, either an interim storage facility or a repository. So additional images here of the dry casks. I used to take my classes to the dry cask here at the Pilgrim nuclear power plant in Plymouth, which is now being decommissioned, and you still have 50 or 60 of these dry casks over here. Very, very safe. But once again, eventually, when these nuclear power plant sites are dismantled, there is a very legitimate desire by the local communities to return to what we call green field, at which point these dry casks got to go somewhere. So they have to go to an optimal repository. And I'm done. I realize that I'm giving a very long answer, but it's important, right? So
this is all good information.
Yeah. So ultimately, they go to a repository or a disposal site, and many studies have been run, and everybody agrees the best way to dispose of this is to put it underground. Okay, so these are what we call geological repositories. And there are different designs. They could be excavated tunnels, or they could be smaller but deeper boreholes. And so different countries have taken different approaches. But the issues have never been the technology or the technical aspects, have always been the political process and the engagement with local communities, so that communities actually are comfortable with being the site of that repository. And so you have example of success, Finland and Sweden. They decided in both cases to actually have these deep geological or this geological repository at existing nuclear power plant sites, which makes a lot of sense. You have already local support for nuclear, you have a capable workforce, you have access routes, things of that type. And then you have examples of failure like the US with Yakima. So at the moment, US does not have a solution. It's not a crisis, I want to underline this, in a sense that we can continue to accumulate these dry casks at the sites, very, very safe and relatively cheap, actually, to handle. But at one point, that material's got to go somewhere.
What about reprocessing?
So reprocessing refers to taking that spent fuel, which has still a lot of valuable elements in it, in particular, the residual uranium, right, and plutonium, which can be used as fuel, separate that useful material from the fission products, which is the bulk of the radioactivity, reuse that useful material in reactors, and only dispose of the fission products. Right. Sounds like a great idea. Don't we like to, you know, reprocess and recycle and reuse?
That's recycle.
And recycle, yes. It is a good idea in theory, but it does introduce complexity, cost, and also some additional issues. First of all, even when you separate the fission products from the useful material, yes, you have reduced the amount of material that you have to dispose of, but you're not eliminated it. So you still have radioactive material that is going to be radioactive for a long time that has to be disposed of. And if you, you know, I just try to impress on you that the issue has never been technical or how much material you have to dispose of. The issue has always been how you manage it politically. So I don't think it's going to make much of a difference, frankly, if you reprocess. The other issue is when you separate particularly plutonium from the other things. Well, plutonium-239, the isotope 239 happens to be good fuel for reactors, but it's also good fuel for nuclear weapons. So separating it create potentially a path towards proliferation. And so and then lastly, I would say reprocessing is certainly more expensive than simply putting it in those dry casks and then ultimately put it in underground. So yeah, there, as usual, you know, Larry, there is no free lunch. So yes, it sounds like a good idea. It's got its bugs, right? So I personally, as you can gather from my long response here, I'm personally in favor of using dry casks and then putting the material underground. But the government's got to sort of pull its act together and find a site with proper engagement of local communities.
Recycling has always, you know, is very topical. We want to recycle lots of things in our economy. Yeah. As far as I can tell, and I'm going out on a limb here, and I could be very wrong, aluminum cans are the only things that we recycle with any kind of economic profitability. It's almost always cheaper to get more material. Maybe we're going to run out of material at some point, and maybe that will change.
Yeah, I can't comment on aluminum and other materials. I can tell you that one reason for the initial interest in reprocessing and recycling the spent fuel was a fear that we would run out of uranium. Yeah. Well, that was 60, 70 years ago. We now know that there is an enormous amount of uranium out there. So you don't really need to recycle for that reason. And the amount of material, as I mentioned at the beginning, is low because of the energy density of uranium. So so really, that's not a good argument for recycling, for uranium, for spent fuel.
Yeah. So on the waste smaller plants, what about from a safety standpoint? Are you say just, you know, in terms of radiation exposure and so forth, it's just the boundary of the plant site. But what about, you know, terrorism and, you know, things like that? People trying to get their hands on one of these to get, as you suggest, plutonium or some other radioactive material and use as terrorist.
Yeah. Security is paramount and not just safety. What you're asking is really security questions. And so all these new designs are designed for a very high level of security. And that starts with the design of the machine, the design of the reactors themselves, right? So the access to fuel, the barriers that you have between the fuel and potential attackers, as well as the fact that you put them below grade, there has to be a, you know, an on-site security force, particularly for the larger plants, and so on. So this is a very high concern slash priority for the designers and particularly for the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, because all of this is under the jurisdiction of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. So there is no such thing as a reactor that can be deployed without a thorough analysis of its security profile and basically the evaluation of all the possible scenarios.
Do you have any thoughts on this situation we're seeing in Ukraine with regard to the susceptibility of the big plant, the biggest plant in Europe? It's not a small plant, it's a big plant, you know?
Yeah, certainly concerning situation. The potential consequences have been greatly exaggerated in the media. There is certainly a fascination with nuclear accidents. And so this, you know, apocalyptic scenario are physically, that I've heard of, are physically impossible. Nonetheless, nuclear power plants, like all other power plants, were not designed for a war zone. So they're sturdy. You know, they, if you look at the what we call the containment structure, which is essentially a meter plus thick reinforced concrete structure, that's pretty robust, but it's not meant to withstand, you know, cruise missiles and heavy artillery and all of that. And so the potential for doing damage there is high. For the Zaporizhia site in particular, though, those six reactors have been shut down now for several weeks, which means the level of radioactivity within the reactor cores and the decay heat, the heat that has to be removed, have gone down dramatically. So the driving force, so to speak, for a release and for an accident is becoming smaller and smaller with time. So that's, I suppose, the silver lining here.
Let me ask maybe two more questions, two or three. How do we rebuild our skilled nuclear savvy workforce?
Well, I suppose you're asking the right person and the right audience here, because that's what we do at MIT, right? Jokes aside, what's interesting is that the construction and operation of these plants requires not only folks that we train, actually, in my department, so the masters and the PhDs, many of whom actually end up working at either technology companies or national labs, et cetera. But even more mundane sort of more blue collar positions are very, very much in demand here, because you need certified and specialized electricians, welders, masons, and so on. And so I think there is a role across the spectrum here for educational institutions like MIT and others, from community colleges, all the way up to the PhDs. Yeah, but I don't see I don't see any other way. I mean, you got to just sort of attract people to the field, and the jobs are out there, by the way. The companies are hiring like there is no tomorrow. They're actually competing with each other for people at every level. So it's a good time to be looking for a job in the nuclear industry, because you can probably fetch higher than average salaries just because of the scarcity of supply, so to speak.
So for people in our audience here who are either considering their career choices or maybe coursework if they're in school, what advice would you give them? Over then jump in.
that's a great question, Larry. And if what you're interested in is sort of an intro level, or I should say a basic level introduction to nuclear technology, it just happens that we created at MIT in 2019 a MOOC, a massive online open course on nuclear energy. And this was a departmental effort led by me and four other colleagues. And so far we had some outrageous number of students. So we offered it every spring. And I want to say that we have had something like 16,000-17,000 students taking the course worldwide. So, so again, if what you're interested in is sort of, okay, I want to learn a little bit more about nuclear technology. And by the way, not just fission, that course covers fusion, it covers quantum information. It's a bit of a potpourri of everything related to nuclear science and technology, not just nuclear energy technology. Mm-hmm. I would recommend the MIT MOOC, the nuke MOOC, as we call it.
Is that the nuke MOOC? Yeah, is that online or is it?
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's absolutely online. It's to, uh, and And you remember that all our courses are numbers. So this is 22011X. And the X is because it's online. So 22011X.
Okay, good. One more question. For this the nuclear batteries and the SMRs and AMRs, you had a price to build the plant. You didn't have a price for LCOE, as I recall.
Well, there is a target LCOE for the small modular reactors. If you talk or even search the information that's been provided by vendors, which incidentally you should take with a grain of salt because they're out there selling their products, right? They're all targeting LCOEs below $50 per megawatt hour.
5 cents a kilowatt hour.
Yeah, 5 cents per kilowatt hour, which is good. If you're low carbon baseload or dispatchable, that's actually pretty good cost.
That's SMRs and AMRs.
Yeah, SMR and AMRs. Now for the nuclear batteries, there is an economy of scale. So the smaller you go, the higher will be the cost of the electricity and heat generated. Okay, so they're going to be a little bit more expensive, but you can make up for that gap because they're co-located. So you don't pay transmission and distribution, right? The whole point, I spent 20 minutes talking about that, is that you don't need transmission. You don't need to be a remote. You can actually put it right next to the user. And so and that makes up for the difference. But yes, they are a little bit more expensive because unfortunately that's just physics. Smaller reactors are less efficient than large reactors.
What would you say? 60 bucks, 80 bucks per megawatt?
No, a little bit more. By our estimate, a little bit more. This could be between $80 and $120 per megawatt hour.
Yeah, okay, all right. I would think that you get the economies, the same kind of economies we saw in the computer business where you went from, these refrigerator-sized mainframes and mini computers to desktops and laptops and the prices because they were smaller and you get this learning curve effect. You're saying not yet. You're saying
well, no. The point that you bring up is well taken, and that would be construction costs. But you're asking about LCOE. LCOE has a bunch of other things. It has to the extent that you need some human operators around, you got to pay them. And if your plant only spits out the 5 megawatts as opposed to 1,000 megawatt, you lose there. The other thing is fuel. So, yep. And that's where the efficiency part comes into play, because smaller cores tend to be leakier in terms of neutrons. So this is very technical, but the idea is that they have a less efficient, what we call neutron economy. There is a less efficient utilization of the fuel. So the fuel itself costs you a little bit more in small reactors than it costs you in larger reactors.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. We're really pushing the time.
I say, Doug is giving us the sign there.
Us the sign.
So hey, listen, what can I say? That's the most amount of information I've ever heard about nuclear in general, and a lot of it pretty new and I would say innovatively presented. So thank you very much, Jacopo, for showing that. I had never heard the expression nuclear battery before. I think it's a great name, and let's hope we see lots of those sometime in our future. Sarah, please come on back on and join us as well. And all I want to do now is to show you, well, first of all, thanking you guys, Larry, for your excellent moderating skills, and of course, Jacopo, the main man, for that wealth of information that we got. Our next event is going to feature another MIT professor, Kerry Emanuel. Some of you maybe heard from him back in, I think it was 2014, when we had him here to talk about what we know about climate change. He's going to give us sort of an update to all of that and some new ideas in this area. And I think it's very appropriate because we've had a lot of change in the last year or two in terms of the prospects for managing climate change and so on. And can't say that the news has always been good. So we're going to get the assessment from somebody who studied this for almost his entire career, and he's very, very capable in this area. So I'm hoping many of you here are going to join us for that one as well and listen to another really top expert from MIT talk about a field of really great importance. So with that, again, a final thank you to everybody, and have a great evening, all of you. Thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Thanks so much.
Bye-bye. Have a nice
evening. Thank you, Jacopo.
Bye-bye.